We'll get to the serious part of this video in just a few seconds, but I just needed to show you guys my new weird Japanese drink, and I'm gonna read it for you. Lemon skashu plus vinegar. Yeah, that's basically lemon vinegar juice. I've no idea how this can be drinkable. Oh wait, I see it here. First ingredient is sugar. That's gonna be amazing. Oh my god, that's... wow. It tastes vinegar more than lemon. And it's sweet. I don't know how I feel about this. Hey everyone and welcome to another episode. I'm Ombarus, and this week it's gonna be a little bit of a rant, but bear with me a little bit because I think you'll find it a little bit useful. I like to think of the way I program as a sort of philosophy of design, and I've called it the middle ground through exploration design philosophy. And let me tell you what I mean by that. Throughout my past videos, I've often shown how I designed this or that system, like how I made my UI, or how I made the gameplay, or how I made the data system for my game, and so on. And you might be thinking that I spend a lot of time designing every single system, but that's not the case. A lot of the experience I have as a programmer is knowing when I should spend a lot of time designing some things and when I should just like wing it and do whatever comes to my mind. And I do this by considering a couple of different points, and I'm going to talk a little bit about these. Of course, the first thing you have to consider when you start designing some system is how much time you have to spend on it. If I'm making a game in 1 year, or if I'm making a game in 5 years, then the amount of time I'm gonna spend designing each system is gonna be very different. And the reason for that is if I'm spending 5 years on a system, I want to make sure it's future-proof. But if I'm spending like a couple of days on something, then, you know, I can just be done with it and forget that it ever happened. Then the second thing is knowing how much I know about the system, figuring out how much experience I have already with whatever I'm designing, whether it's AI, physics, rendering, shaders. Like, if you've never touched these, then it's going to be very hard to figure out what the best use case is and what are the pitfalls that you're going to encounter while you're designing your system, and it's going to be hard to make it basically future-proof. Even if you think, oh well, I'll just look it up online, I'll look at tutorials, and I'll take someone else's design, it's hard to evaluate which design is going to be best for you if you don't have experience working with this kind of system. You're not going to know which part of a given tutorial or a given idea is going to apply to your problem. The third part is related to this. You have to know the system, but you also have to know the tools you're going to be using. So the first time I booted Godot, I didn't know much about the engine, so it was kind of hard for me to think of how I was going to design my software or my architecture, because I didn't know what nodes were, I didn't know how the data was working, I didn't know what I could do with JDScript. The more you know about the language, the better you can plan your design. For example, recently I've been trying out Unreal Engine, and it's very, 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 very different than Godot. So a lot of the stuff I've been doing in Godot, I've been trying to do it in Unreal, but the philosophy of the engine itself is just different. The fact that a lot of the files are binaries, and the fact that, you know, it's using a lot of C++ and blueprints, it just means that it's not as easy as it is in Godot to implement certain patterns. But then there's other patterns that are easier to implement using Unreal Engine. Now, if you're working alone on your own project, this next point might not be so important. But if you're working as part of a team, then one of the things you really have to consider is who's going to be using the system you're designing. Because if you're making it for other programmers, then maybe it's fine to just have an API to your system that can be interfaced with C# or C++ or something. But if you're making it for a bunch of game designers, then maybe you need to expose some kind of parameters in folders and files that are easy to tweak for the game designer. And if you're making it for an artist that maybe doesn't even have any idea about the game, then you need to give him tools that will have a UI that maybe integrates even with 3D Max or Blender or something that he's going to be able to use in his normal workflow. And this, of course, is going to be very important in the way you design the final system that you're going to make. Because if it interacts with JSONs, or if it interacts with XML, or if it interacts with Blender, it's going to be a completely different beast. My next point is just what issues I've had in the past with these kind of systems. And it might seem obvious, but having experience just can really catapult your design into something really awesome really quickly. For example, I've had a lot of experience doing panning and zooming for isometric cameras, so I already know the kind of issues I'm gonna find, I already know what it should look like, and I've worked on physics, and I've worked on animation, so I kind of know where to go with these kind of things to avoid the most common issues. Even if I haven't implemented the solution, I know my design is going to support it. Sometimes I get people asking me, but why did you design it like that? You know, wouldn't it be simpler to just have done it like this or something? And it's kind of hard for me to explain that because of all the issues I've encountered in the past, I decided to make it like that. Maybe they're not handling those issues right now, but I've had so much trouble with those issues that I need to make it the way it is right now. My sixth point is, you have to take into account how important the system you're designing is going to be compared to everything else. Because if you're making the end screen UI for your game, then maybe it's not worth spending a couple of hours designing it, just make it. But if you're trying to make the rendering engine for your game, even though it's a very, very difficult thing to design, since it can make or break your game, it's probably a good idea to hire some very professional, very experienced people and give them a lot of time to think about the design. And what I mean by something very difficult to design is my 7 points. You have to take into account how coupled your system is going to be with everything else. I think there's kind of like 3 layers. There's some stuff that are really easy to decouple. For example, the file system is usually something that you can define an interface, and then everything in the background is just a black box and you have no idea what's happening. I mean, it could be streaming stuff, it could be caching files, it could be doing, you know, compression, decompression, encryption. You don't really need to know about all these things. All you need is a read method and a write method and maybe a stream method, but that's about it. And so that means it's very easy to decouple from everything else, and you can make a very elegant design that no one is ever going to see. But then there's the opposite. There are systems that have their fat finger inside every single other system of your engine. And these are very hard to design because they just need to interface with every other design you have, which means they're going to be kind of a monster with all these tentacles that need to be able to interface with everything. An example of that is, for example, a tracking system where you want to send some information to some server about your user behavior. Well, you're going to have to implement this inside everything. The tutorial system, the contract system, the UI system, the online system, everywhere. And that makes it very difficult to design properly. And another example is the online, because everything is going to want to talk to the server, and you're going to have dedicated server, and you're going to have pooling, and you're going to have all these kind of things, and it's going to have to be integrated in every single component of your game. So it's going to be very hard to have a good design. I mean, you can have interface and you can make it pretty, but it's going to be very hard to have anything more complex than that. And then you have the in-betweens, like the physics or the UI. These are pretty complex systems that are quite often integrated in a lot of different systems, but if you're careful, you can kind of figure out a way to design them in a way that's going to be user-friendly and decoupled a little bit. And really, it's the one I like the most to design because they are a challenge, but at the same time, they can be very rewarding to design properly. And these are the like 7 points I think about when I try to make up my own design. For example, am I making a game in 1 week with online components which I have very little experience with in a language I've never used, like Haskell? Well then, fuck design, I'm just gonna do it as fast as I can and hammer it until it works, and I'll just call it done. But if I'm working with a team of 50 or 100 people, and I'm going to be working on the game for 3 or 4 years, and they've given me the job of implementing the camera system for the whole game, then maybe I'm going to spend even 1 month just laying down the foundation and thinking of everything, how I'm going to design everything, and I'm going to revisit this design regularly all the time to try to improve it. But when I'm going to be done, I'll hand it out to the game designer, and they're going to have tools to tweak it, they're going to be able to look at it live in-game, they're going to be able to debug it, there's going to be complex cutscene systems, tools, UI for it, you name it, I'll have it. But yeah, it really depends. And that's what I mean when I say you have to think about the middle ground, is that you have to consider what is a good amount of design for the situation you're in right now. And that will require you doing some exploration. It can be in the sense that you have to think about the possibilities a little bit, you have to talk to other people, you have to look online for other solutions, but it also means that you might have to prototype some stuff to figure out how complex it's going to be. You might need to play around a little bit with the engine to familiarize yourself with the language. And that's what I mean by exploring and trying to find a middle ground. I've met programmers who are like, I've done it this way before, and that's how it needs to be done. And they always want to do it the same way. You need test-driven development, and this is the one and only way to make proper software. And yeah, maybe it works for you, I don't know. But personally, I think there's a time and place for everything, and test-driven development might be cool if you have like some huge project, but maybe it's a little bit hard to implement if you're doing something very, very quickly. And yeah, having components and architecture and all of that is really cool, but if you're making, again, a game jam, maybe it's fine to just make it all in one file. And that's what I mean by having to try to find a middle ground and being open to changing your mind and changing your perspective. And that's gonna be it for me this week. I'm sorry, I want to make a more tutorial video like I often do, but once again, these last couple of weeks, I've been working on a contract, which of course I'm not allowed to talk about, but it's paying the rent and it's paying my food, so I kind of had to take it. But that also means that I'm a little bit short on time and ideas for my videos right now. So I'm doing my best. You guys are my number one priority. So the only thing I can say is I'll be back as soon as I can, and see you guys in my next episode. Bye!